Okay. Hi, Jack.
Hi, Lynette.
How are you?
Fabulous.
Fabulous. I'm going to do a quick intro of how I know you, because that would probably make sense. And I'm not even sure that you know how I know you. Last year, for the record, for anybody that's watching, because I don't know if they know who I am. My name's Lynette Young. I am the founder and curator, because it sounds fancy, of Women of Google Plus, but that's my latest claim to fame. I've actually been a technology specialist in some way, shape, or form for 23 years. Which I always think is amazing because I'm like 25 or something, but you know. I've been doing this for.
I thought you were like 25.
Did you?
And when you,
25?
I did think that you were like 25, and when we, you know, when we came back from Vegas, and then we started talking, and you told me about your kids and stuff, and I was like, get out! I thought you were 25.
No, I'm not. I hit the big 40 last year, but so that's me in a nutshell. And you know, there's Google, so you could always search my name. But how I actually met or heard of Jacqueline Carly, because that's who we're talking to tonight. How I actually met Jack is last year, right before I turned 40. I got on this huge, like, if I turn 40 and I look like the blob that I am right now physically, like, I will be set that way in memory for the rest of my life, and I will have no choice but to be a big, fat, soft blob. So I got on this kick at 39 and a half that I was going to exercise and get myself healthy and all these other kind of things. So what do? I turn to the internet, right? And I had first found you on Pulse Network early last year, it must have been. And so that's how I found you. And then I got to meet you last year at Blog World or something. We were out on the left coast. So that's pretty much my story of how I know Jack now.
That's so neato.
So that's that. So you were inspiration to get me off my butt. I've actually lost like 7% body fat, which is huge for women, I think.
It is.
So I'm still on that kick, thankfully. I'm actually starting a little bit of a CrossFit. Like, I think my trainer's trying to trick me into doing CrossFit, and he's not telling me what it is, but I know what it is. But anyway, that's how I first knew of Jack. Is through all of the support and motivation that she and all the content she puts out online about wellness and fitness and health. So that's that. But I thought that her story would be really interesting for so many of the people that circle me or that are interested in finding out more about Women of Google Plus, because you've had this amazing story of how you started out to kind of where you are now by fulfilling dreams that you've had for quite some time. So do you want to give me some the 411 on your history?
Sure. let's see. Okay, so, well, I originally started out in music. Music was my thing when I was younger. And it was, I knew early on that was what I wanted to do. And so that was kind of the path that I took. And I I started taking private voice lessons when I was very young, and then I went to a private boarding school for high school and studied with a private teacher there and got a scholarship and did competitions and all that kind of stuff, and then went to study in Europe because I was interested in singing opera, and that's when I went to do that, and then I went off to college and I had a music scholarship for opera performance. In the midst of all that, I had a really, really bad eating disorder, and I was bulimic for many years, and I was also clinically depressed, and I had struggled with my weight. I was overweight most of my childhood and adolescence and going into my early 20s and stuff. So even though I was pursuing, you know, my dream, so to speak, I was dealing with a lot of self-esteem issues, demons, stuff like that. And that ended up kind of derailing me from my path. And so I focused on that, on being sick pretty much for a long time. And then from there, after I kind of hit bottom, which you do, you know, when you are sick, I started focusing on my health and getting well and doing a lot of research on holistic therapies and nutrition and was on medication. I ended up going to a holistic nutrition school to learn about nutrition. Hang on a second. Can you not stand there because you're, you're like freaking
shush.
Me out.
Shush.
Sorry, everyone.
Go throw an iPad over there. Yeah. We'll go follow it.
So I ended up enrolling in a holistic nutrition school more to work on my relationship with food. Because at that point, I had no relationship with food. It was, I was barely eating anything that I did eat. I was throwing up. I had become very secluded. I didn't want to see any of my friends, was no longer doing anything social, stopped singing, constantly had a sore throat, all these really bad side effects from being bulimic. So I went to this nutrition school to kind of work on my relationship along with therapy. And what ended up happening was is that I just learned all of these things that I didn't know. I knew the very traditional kind of in-the-box model of food and, the standard American diet and how that works, and never really understood that there was even a connection, a mind-body connection, and that what you eat can affect how you feel and so on. So that was a huge revelation to me, and it was the first time that I had been in a room with people that were not preoccupied with how they looked or how much they weighed or anything to do with body image. And that was like, whoa, to me. Who knew that there were people like this that even existed? And so that began my journey into nutrition. And at the time, then I was also working for Equinox Fitness Club. And there, I had started working for them in high school, so I had worked pretty much every position that there was, from front desk to front desk manager, membership sales manager, at personal training, and later on I became a fitness instructor for other gyms, and I pursued that path. And as I started to pursue that path, I got better, and the more that I got better, the more determined I was to stay better and then to start helping other people. And so that's where I went with that, and that's how I became Fitterella.
It's funny because I've been part of, the thing that I've been on for the past year, year and a half, is that I realize that there's a connection that if you physically feel out of sorts, that if you don't feel like you belong in your own body, it's so hard to go any further with anything else. Like, you had just kind of recently publicly announced that you were kind of going back and finding your passion with singing again, that it almost seems like once you got yourself under control, you were able to kind of let go and do the things that you really wanted to do. And I'm kind of seeing that a little bit even with myself, but other people as well too, that I know that it's like this gate that you can't get past, that when you have these issues with yourself or relationships with food or how you view your own body, you just can't go any further. So it almost sounds like that's kind of what happened to you, because I was like I said, I knew you from when, Fitterella type stuff, and, as a, looking at it as a holistic view, which is much more in mindset with what drew me to you in the first place. But now I'm seeing like there's so much more to you that I find incredibly interesting. So do you think that had something to do with it? You finally got to where you needed to be physically with your own self, that comfortable, that it helped you kind of open up to your dreams that you wanted to do?
Yeah, that definitely had, was a big part of it, I think. But it also, there were, so once I was on my path in terms of getting well, and I've been in recovered from my eating disorder now for over 10 years, and been working with other people to help get their health on track and to reach their goals, and I've loved every minute of it. And the more that I've been able to help other people, the more that it's helped me learn more and do better myself. But there was still this other part that was kind of, that I never really fully addressed. And I think that was also kind of a part of of being in a fulfilling relationship, and also a spiritual side, a spirituality part. And it's not that those are necessary for everybody, but I think that those are things that are rounding out for me right now. And as they've been rounding out, I feel like that's part of what gave me the courage to step out and follow and to all of a sudden want to pursue my dreams in music, because now I feel, I think those things have helped me to learn to deal with fear and to learn to not get rid of my fear, because I have not gotten rid of my fears and I don't know that I ever will, but just to feel supported and to feel loved and to feel like it's okay to take a chance because I have the support that I need, that I have that, you know, something, I have the person and now my spiritual beliefs and stuff like that to help kind of move me along and be by my side.
I think there's a lot to be said for that. For, you know, sometimes I felt that if you have negative influences in your life, like if you want to do something or pursue something professionally or personally or spiritually, that, you know, if you have someone in your life or something in your life that's a negative influence on that, well, that's a no-brainer. That's really going to draw your energy from wanting to do that. But sometimes being neutral or not having anything is a detriment as well. And that's what it kind of sounded like for you. And now you have a positive influence in your life that is helping you kind of with that extra push that maybe what you needed. I just find that really interesting that...
Yeah. You know, well, I'm sorry.
No, I was going to say that, you know, it's not just the lack of negative that matters. It has to be the inclusion of something positive.
Absolutely. Well, and when I went on that path with the nutrition and stuff like that, and as I got better and doing my thing, I also, in the midst of that, before when this happened, I had something that happened with one of my teachers, where she had said something to the effect of, it's never going to happen for you. And, you know, you might as well pack it in right now. And so at that time, I had crap self-esteem. You know, I took what she said was kind of like my end-all be-all. And I took what she said as gospel. So it was very easy for me to hang my hat on that and say, she said it, so it must be true. I don't even need to try. It was easy for me to use that as an excuse to say I don't have to try anymore. And so I totally got rid of music in my life. And then once I had my daughter, then I said, oh, well, now, I mean, come on. I'm going to be a mom now. I don't have time. Yeah. I have to make money to pay the bills. You know, my shot is over, and it will never happen to me. So those things were, it was very easy for me to let, they're all fear-based. They're all fear-based things. So-and-so said this, and I believed it, and so I'm never going to have the balls to take a chance to prove that person otherwise. And then the other thing was, is, you know, fear about me not being able to ever try this because I have to be a good mom, I have to make a living, I have, you know, all this other stuff, so I can't possibly try to go for my dreams. So when these other things came full circle for me now, like I said, about the relationship and spirituality and having a support system and really working on those things, It opened up that door without me realizing that it was opening up that door. I'm a yoga teacher. I did my 200-hour yoga teacher training last year, and it was absolutely amazing and phenomenal, and had all of these really incredible experiences, because it's not just about the poses, it's about opening up to so much more. And so then this year, I'm doing my 500-hour advanced training. So it's the 500 on top of the 200.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it takes like over a year. And it's with this amazing teacher, Rolf Gates. So the first weekend that we started, he had us do this exercise where he wanted us to talk about our intentions, the intentions that we were going to set to kind of frame the duration of our 500-hour. And so the first thing we had to do was journal, right? So we sat there for like 5 minutes, and you had to just kind of do like a pre-conscious streaming thing. And then after that, then he paired you up with somebody, and then you were supposed to share that with the other person. And then after that, then you were supposed to get up in front of everybody and say what it is that you, what your intention was and stuff. So I wrote down a bunch of things, and it was about, you know, about speaking to people, about helping them, and then it was about teaching and stuff like that. And then I did say, you know, and maybe sing and stuff like that. And I spoke to the girl, and we did a one-on-one, and I said the same thing, and it's teaching, and I want to be able to teach and help people, and I want to speak. I love speaking to people about getting their health and their wellness and all this other stuff. And then it came time that he called my name to stand up and say what I was going to say. And I got up and I had my piece of paper and I looked, and then I looked at everybody and I said, I want to be a singer. And I thought, that's not what I had written down. That's not what I told the girl when we were talking. Mm-hmm. But that was what came out. And it was in that moment that I realized that there was this unresolved thing within me that I wanted to and that I need to pursue. And it's in whatever format it takes. You know, when I say that, it doesn't mean that I'm going to be touring, you know, or something, doing a Madonna tour or whatever, or maybe I will be.
Maybe
who knows? It just means that I want to sing, however that comes to be. And it's taking form now in a really interesting way.
Now, there's actually something that I want to go back and ask you, because I didn't know if you were going to bring it up or not, but you mentioned that you have a daughter, mm-hmm. and I do as well, and I think they're around the same age. But do you feel... I mean, especially as a woman that has a daughter. I mean, I have a son also, but my daughter's older, but there's something about being the built-in role model for a girl that really made me adjust how I behave and what I think out loud and my own self-image and self-worth. Have you found that by the sheer fact of being a mother to a girl, it has shifted your ideas a little bit of how you...
No.
Act?
Absolutely. Well, and since I've had my daughter, my number one fear is that I don't want her to end up with the self-esteem issues, the body issues, the, you know, the lack of personal power or anything like that. You know, I want her to love herself and be confident and, you know, and all of those things, all of the things that I wasn't. So I'm conscious all the time of wanting to model for her now someone that is strong and somebody that is following their passions and following their dreams and doing the things that make her happy. It's interesting, though, and I find it tricky sometimes, though, because she's 7. And so kids see everything, and they're looking at other families and other parents and seeing what their friends' parents do. And sometimes what she sees in other parents or and stuff like that, she, I guess, is kind of thinking, well, that's the right way to do it, or that's the way I should be doing it. And then she comes to me and kind of questions why I'm doing it that way. How come I'm not staying home all the time like so-and-so's mommy, you know, and how come I don't bake a lemon meringue pie like so-and-so's mommy? I don't bake a lemon meringue pie like so-and-so's mommy, but, you know, mommy does other things with you, and so it's tricky. It's like I want to be able to empower her and be this role model so she can see that she can do all these things, but at the same time, I don't want her to be to be feeling bad that I'm not doing these other mommy things and stuff. So I'm trying to find that balance where, you know, I'm maybe like 15% June Cleaver or something, or 20%, you know, and where we do baking things, but the other part, I really just am trying to be conscious about being a good role model, an example for her to be, to grow into a strong, powerful young lady.
Yeah, I'm definitely in the same battle. My daughter's 10 and a half, and I constantly, you know, as long as she's exposed to a lot of different versions of normal.
Yeah.
And she understands what that is, that's the key here. But, you know, she has certain pride in the fact that I'm not normal.
Well, like, you're the mommy with the purple hair. That's
exactly.
So cool.
How many moms have purple hair? Actually, her music teacher has blue streaks, and I let her bleach out the very front of her hair, and it's bright teal now, and she's 10, so she's pretty cool in school right now, I'm sure. But the various
so
different
cool.
reasons, of things of normal. Like, for us, it's like we work from home most times, so, you know, we're not stay-at-home parents in the traditional sense, or I'm not a stay-at-home mom in the traditional sense, but, you know, she's adjusted to the fact that when I'm sitting here or on the phone or whatever, it's work. But, yeah, I guess that just exposing them to the different versions of normal.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny because, like I said, what I've known of you online, you know, I only know pieces, and that's why I was really interested in talking to you today, but I had no idea that you were, you know, opera classical singer. My daughter's actually in lessons now. She's been about a year and a half, and we just upped her teacher to a really hardcore teacher, but she's taking classical singing lessons because she's got some pipes on her. But yeah, I see what it does for self-confidence and self-esteem, but I see how it could swing the other way pretty drastically too. So I'm always kind of nervous on that. Like, if, you know, I don't want to overinflate her artificially. But, you know, that idea of, just like you said, that you encountered a teacher that was like, you know, just forget it, give it up. Like I don't ever want that to happen, but I can see that someday it will. And, you know, knowing that that's a possibility and kind of not being a total helicopter mom and sheltering her from everything, but knowing how to protect it when it happens. Because, you know, now, you know, I see the effects, you know, and young girls anyway, and young to be even to your middle 20s for that matter. Your self-esteem, I think, and your ego is pretty fragile, despite what we claim to think.
Yeah, definitely. And I had just so many issues and stuff. And I look, you know, I look back now, and she was a very, whatever, you know, I wish her the best, and she was fitter and stuff like that. But, you know, the me today, I want to go back and be like, you know,
exactly.
you know, are you kidding me?
So tell me, because I know that you just went, you know, I'll call it vacation, retreat, whatever. So tell me, like, what this was for you, what it meant for you to build up to actually saying, okay, I'm going to go do this. And I want to hear a little bit, if you're willing to share, about your experience there.
So I just came back from a week-long yoga and Kirtan retreat in Big Sur, California. Chris and I went, and Kirtan is as Girish, who I'm going to be talking about, he's a very well-known chant artist that I adore. He calls it kind of like Sanskrit gospel music, except it's like call and response. So in this, the music, the words are in our mantras, and they're in Sanskrit. And it doesn't really matter what they mean. It's just about the sound of the words and how they make you feel and what the music. So there's no religious connotation to this. You don't have to be any religion. It doesn't matter if you're Jewish or Christian or whatever. This is all about just letting out what's inside, whether you can sing or you can't sing, just expressing yourself. So the kirtan means the chances the singer sings them, and the people that are there sing the same thing in response. And the music can start off slow, and then it gets faster, and there are people dancing, and it's really amazing. So I have been exploring kirtan ever since I decided that I wanted to start singing again, and because I'm into yoga, and it's kind of enmeshed into the yoga community and so forth. So Chris and I went on this retreat, and the yoga teacher is my yoga teacher, Rolf Gates, who is the one that's teaching me for my 500 hour, and he is very good friends with Girish. So when I found out that they were going to have this retreat, I thought, well, I have to go, because not only is it going to be my yoga teacher, but it's going to be my favorite chant artist in the same place. Like, this is amazing.
That's a no-brainer. Yeah, you have to
go. Totally have to go. Once I talked Chris into going to a retreat where he had to do yoga twice a day, every day, I had contacted Rolf's wife, actually, because she takes care of his stuff, and said, hey, by any chance, can you maybe, find out if Girish would be okay with giving me, like, a private lesson or something? You know, I'd really love to be able to learn how to play one of his songs. I'm learning to play the harmonium, which is, if you can imagine, it's, I have pictures posted on my profile, but it's, if you can imagine, it's like an accordion, but it's, you don't hold it, it's here, so here's like the piano, and there's bellows in the back, and you push the bellows back and forth, and you play with this hand. It's made in India, and it's a woodwind instrument. It's beautiful, and it's traditionally used in kirtan. I said, so she hooked me up with an email with his wife, and his wife emailed me, and I sent her an email with my story saying, my whole everything, and saying, no, I want to come back to music. Girish is my favorite, and please, 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 please. And,
so you fangirled over it.
Yes, big time. Oh, you don't even know how I fangirled this past week. Forget it. So she said she spoke to Girish, and Girish said, yes, of course. And I thought, oh, okay. So we end up going there, and I end up meeting him because he's playing music for the whole time, all the retreat. So while we're doing yoga, he's playing and he's singing. And also he was doing these kind of like workshops and stuff like that with us. And he gave me, I had a private lesson with him every day, which was amazing. I posted some pictures today on my profile where you'll see where I'm in his, where he was in his little house that he was staying in. And I got to sing with him, and he was teaching me to play his songs on the harmonium, and Chris videotaped all of the lessons, and it was amazing. And the whole time, I felt like I was on cloud nine. And not only was that happening, but we were also then doing yoga, and Chris was having like these amazing breakthroughs with his yoga, because he was just really focused on it and doing so great. And Big Sur is right on the water. It was the most beautiful place, hot spring. So it was really kind of like an enchanted week. And then we find out that Girish is doing a big kirtan concert on the Thursday, the night before we're leaving, and that his band is coming in from Santa Cruz. The cool thing about Girish's music is that it's like traditional, however thousands of years, mantras meshed with very cool, funky, world music, drums. He raps some of the mantras.
Wow.
It's like really amazing, modern music, but with these things, which is what I love so much about it. And then he asked me if I want to sing with him in the concert.
Right then and there, or did he ask you prior? Did he, like, put you on the spot right there?
No, he asked me on Tuesday, and the concert was on Thursday, on our second lesson. He asked me if I wanted to sing with him, and I was like, yeah. So here I am. So the thing about this whole thing is that, and it's kind of too long of a story to talk about, but I've been working a lot with setting intentions and kind of putting it out there, what I see. So this whole thing that's happening with Garish, I had already written it down months ago. I had already been working, Rolf, who's the yoga teacher, is also my coach. I had already written in my book about how I was, you know, Garish was going to hear me sing, and then he was going to invite me to sing with him, and blah, 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 and all this stuff. So now all of this stuff is actually happening in real life, and I can't believe it, because it's, you know, for those of you that believe, it's like the law of attraction. And that's truly what it feels like, and it's all of a sudden, the more that you put out into the universe and that you believe, it happens. So that's what happened. And I sang with him. I performed with my favorite chant artist in the world in a concert with his band, and I sang all of the songs with him. So I did backup and led all of the chant responses for all the songs. And it was amazing. It was like I never left singing ever, and exactly where I was supposed to be. So it's pretty cool. That's pretty cheesy, but cool.
No, be quiet. That's an amazing, amazing story. Where do you think, because, okay, this isn't the pinnacle of like, okay, I'm done now.
Right.
Because you've reached these things that you had intentions on doing.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do with it now? Like, where do you feel? I know you're just like a day out of this, so it's probably all still very fresh. That's probably a really good time to ask you. But where do you feel that this is going to put you next? Because this is the point in your life, I would have to guess. This is a pivot point for you. This is something that happened to you that you had planned going in, but I don't think that you could have expected what you were going to be like on the other side.
Yeah.
When you got back out, being able to sing with him and, you know, lessons and things like that. So where do you think that this is going to go for you going forward? Because singing is back in your life.
Yeah.
Music is back in your life. And now you're going to incorporate it with everything else that you've trailblazed with. So what's next?
Well, I'm going for it. And before this happened that week with Garish, I had sang a couple in a yoga class workshop thing where I had a really amazing response. And then from there, I've had a bunch of other teachers ask me to play in their classes, so I've had a bunch of things booked, and I'm doing my own big Kirtan April 7th in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and so that's been a big event that I've been gearing up with. So Chris has actually become part of my band, and Chris plays guitar, and so we've been doing exploring, you know, putting our own music together. He's also exploring. We're interested in putting, like Garish does with the non-traditional music, we're interested in infusing it with, like, cool electronic music, dubstep, and all really interesting things. So he's, you know, in heaven now, researching all that stuff and checking it out and figuring out how we're going to make it happen. So that was kind of already, you know, in the works before this week happened. However, for me, one of the things that I was kind of still, I guess, and it's probably still that kind of, you know, self-esteem thing, is that, can I do this? Do I sound okay? Yeah, Chris tells me I sound great, but I'm like, yeah, you're my boyfriend, of course. My mother tells me I sound great, of course, you're my mother.
Yeah, you two have to say that.
Yeah, you have to. But then going to this thing and having this person who is, you know, famous in the Kirtan world and has no reason to invite me to sing with him and to be a part of that, but he did, and he told me that he thought that I was amazing, and so that kind of was like, oh, okay, well then, maybe I should. So for me, that was a really big part in terms of me, you know, really confirming that I can do this. But the other parts, I have, you know, Chris and I are exploring how we're going to do the music and make it our own, and we're still feeling our way through that, and we have a lot to learn. But I have three bookings now in March to to perform and sing in a bunch of in three classes, and then I have my big Kirtan in April. And Girish asked me, I might be singing with him on in some of his tour dates as well.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, so that's pretty cool.
That is pretty epic.
Yeah.
Is this something that, it's funny because I had mentioned it to my husband and he knew what the form of music was. He has much
cooler
and broader musical taste than I do. And a friend of mine is actually, he's a holistic physician. He's a naturopath, and he was familiar with it as well.
Yay.
And so I was like, am I the odd person out? I don't know what this is. But is it something that you will, like, compose music of your own and infuse pieces of your own personality? I mean, is it, like, because that sounds very interesting to me, that you can kind of take this and twist it and turn it into exactly, you know, something that's representation of you mm-hmm. as a piece of music. So, you know, not only will you be a singer, you'll be a composer as well, too, I suppose. So.
Yeah, and that, I was speaking to Chris about that, and that's part of me learning, you know, how to play the harmonium, which was really important to me because for a long time, when I studied classical music before, even though I had to take piano lessons and learn music theory and all of that stuff, I pretty much was always just the singer. So you give me the piece of music and I learn how to sing it, and it's whatever it is that the composer wrote or whoever, the songwriter and stuff like that, and that's it. And I really want to be a part of the making of this, of the making of the music and the composing of the music. And so to answer the short answer is yes, that we will be making our own music and composing and making it my own so that it's really a reflection of who I am instead of me just being the voice of something else or someone else's stuff.
That part I love. I love the idea of the creation of things. A lot of what I do for a living is someone said that I copy-paste comment and share or something like that's what I do for a living, and I was like, ooh, really? That's not really what I do for a living, but whatever. Like, there was no unique voice of my own of what I do, and that kind of struck me as odd, but what I'm seeing with what you do is you get to make, like you said, you're not just the voice any longer, and I think that that's important, because everything I've seen you do, like I said, I've known you about about a year now, that I've been seeing that everything you do, it's you're putting yourself into it. You're not staying very sterile out of the situation. And it's probably just a byproduct of being involved and thinking holistically and in the whole larger picture. And the same with your music as well. It seems like you're thinking much larger than the music itself. So I want to say impressed, but I love it. I just think that you Yay. Make a great role model. And and now I have to go find out all the stuff that you do with your music, and I have to find out more because I think it's really interesting. I love the fact that you're public as you can be. I mean, obviously, we don't all dump everything about ourselves online, but I love the fact that you've been exploring this online and sharing this with the people that want to know what you're up to and that want to follow you. Because besides the one time for a couple hours or hour or two that I ran into you at wherever function we were, I don't live near you. Like, the only way that I could, you know, find out what's going on and find out more about you is by the stuff that you post online. And I love the fact that you're, to me anyway, you seem very open with this, open to kind of take people along the journey with you as you figure things out and explore it. So do you have, I don't know, I just want to kind of ask you a little bit about that. How do you feel about that, about kind of bringing people along and maybe making some bumps on the road along the way?
Yeah, so being open about, being open has been always been a part of my healing with my eating disorder and going through all of that stuff. And I found that the more honest I am and open with people, the more that it resonates with others and that they respond to it. This this recent shift for me has been really scary, because I built a following as Fitterella, mm-hmm. and people following me for health and fitness and nutrition-related stuff. And now I'm looking to do music, and I'm, you know, and so I was very, it's scary. It feels scary because, you know, I mean, and I understand people follow me for one thing. And so if I'm saying, hey, this is what I'm going to be focusing on right now, and this is what I'm going to be doing, people may not want to hear it. And they might say, you know what, well, I liked you when you were Fitterella. I don't really care so much for Jacqueline Carly, the singer. Thanks so much, right? And everybody, that's totally cool if that's what you choose. However, you know, it's scary to think, well, that all of a sudden that people are just going to, everybody's going to go away, mm-hmm. so to speak. And then, you know, and all the stuff that I built, you know, what's going to, so I had to think about that for a while and kind of sit with how was I going to do that? Was I going to work on the music stuff kind of behind the scenes and, you know, and but in front of everybody still be Fitterella? And then once the music thing got successful, if it got successful, then I was going to, like, pull the curtain and be like, hey, guess what?
Surprise!
You know, surprise! Yeah. You know, you didn't know about this, but guess what? Now I'm... this is what I'm going to be doing now. And I thought, well, that's not a really cool way to do it, because then I'm not being authentic, and I'm not being the person that I said I was, or the person that I'm trying to represent, or that I represent to people and stuff. And I thought, well, that's not cool.
To me, this made perfect sense. Because, and I really do have to credit my friend Marcus, who is the naturopath that I've been friends with for quite some time, that if you know everything that you were about and that you were talking about and teaching before and leading by example, to me this made a natural progression. Like, the evolution made sense to me. But I guess maybe to others, if they, and that's part of the fear of getting pigeonholed online, is if people know you for one thing and they expect you to do something, and you evolve and others either drop off, which is okay, because, you know, not everything is everybody's thing, but, you know, especially, I mean, I think we all have fragile egos when it comes to being online, that, like, I really don't want to be called, kind of called out on the carpet and say, you know, you're a liar, you switched on me, or anything like that, because I think it would bruise my ego, honestly, or doubt the decisions that I was making going forward. But I have to say, from the outside, it didn't look like you stumbled at all. It was just like, this is part of who I am, and this is something that I'm going to talk about online.
Yeah.
And I loved it.
Well, when that happened, so last year I had changed, so I'm Fitterella on Twitter. And last year there were some other projects that I was going to be working on and that were not so fitness related and that I was going to kind of be doing. And I thought, well, it doesn't really make sense then that I'm Fitterella on Twitter if I'm going to be doing this. And I don't want to have like two Twitter accounts and stuff like that and managing and stuff. So I changed my Twitter account to Jack Carly. And people were like, you're not Jack Carly, you're Fitterella and stuff. And how come you changed and blah, blah, blah. And you know, and they eventually got over it and stuff, but there was kind of this, well, I follow you because you're Fitterella, not because you're going to be doing these other things and stuff. And I still stuck with it, but then eventually the other things that I was doing I decided not to do anyway, so I ended up going back to Fitterella and stuff. So when this whole thing came about, that was still in my mind, and then I thought, well, you know, I can't write about music stuff on, you know, a fitness and nutrition blog and stuff. It's not fair to the people that subscribe. So that was basically when I decided that I was going to do the video of, you know, living your big dream. And I thought, well, I can't be the only one that's doing something right now, but that, you know, really has a dream to be doing something else. There has to be at least one other person out there that wants to be living their big dream. And so that's why I put the video out to see, you know, to put it out there. And so it was kind of like, after I did it, whew, that's it. It's said, people know it now, and that's it. And I am right now creating another site that is just, it's Jacqueline Carly, it's going to be dedicated to this pursuit of music and stuff like that, and I might be taking a break from Fiorella, I might not, I haven't decided yet, but once I posted the video, then it felt so much better, and then I felt like, okay, well, you know what, people that want, now they know, and if you want to come along for the ride and see what happens, then that would be so awesome, and I would totally love that. But if you don't, I understand too. But now you know what the story is.
I keep muting my mic to cough. Yeah, so I have to say, like, I like the idea that you're going to have a site that is you. Because it sounds like it's going to encompass everything. I mean, you said music, but I have a sneaking suspicion that your other passions will creep in there too.
Yeah.
But I have to say, I do like it. It's a struggle, I think, to segment and compartmentalize ourselves online and even offline. I mean, you're like one thing to your family, and you're one thing to your friends, one thing to coworkers, one thing to, heaven forbid, people you used to go to school with, you know, that sort of thing. So it's really hard to kind of break things down and only be one thing at one time.
Right.
Which is what I see not only myself but a lot of women that I talk to dealing with, that, you know, it's like, how do I separate my personal and my professional and my passion, you know, passions in life and my spiritual side. Like, how do I do all this? And I'm like, why do you have to?
Right.
I mean, unless you work at, like, for the United States government or, like, some big regulated industry where you can't talk about anything online and disclose, you know, so much as who you are, you know, why not just start and talk about all of the things that make you interesting? Because I know a lot of what drew me to you is that you talked about multiple things. It wasn't like exercise and do this and don't eat that. And I mean, you talked about a lot of things that, like, that kind of mind-body connection. And this is really what I see this being for you, is it's just a bigger version of the mind and things that you want to do. But the idea of being one thing is pretty boring. And I'm not really interested in following the conversations and the life of someone that is one-sided, one facet, because that's pretty boring. So I have to say, I really like that there's, that you put a lot of yourself out there. So.
Well, I have to say, I mean, Google Plus, and this is not like, you know, like a, you know,
nobody paid me.
Nobody paid me to say this, but Google Plus has been the place that I've found, you know, in the last few months that I post whatever I want about whatever I want, and I don't worry about whether or not I'm in my little fitness niche or whatever. I post about Buddhism and yoga and food and sex and, you know, singing and all kinds of stuff, and that's been really refreshing and freeing for me, where, you know, and if people want to comment or whatever, do whatever, and that's fine, but it's just a, it's been really neat to just be able to kind of get it off my chest and just put it out there and let it fly.
Now, did you go into this with that conscious thought of I'm just going to be me, or did it just kind of evolve? Because when I started out in here, literally 2 hours after I was in here back in that July, I was like, this has to be different for me. It can't be the same thing every place else, because I'm just, you know, if you keep doing what you do, you're going to keep getting what you get. That type of thing.
If I
keep doing what I'm doing every place else, I'm going to keep getting what I have, which is not, I want more.
Yeah, no, so absolutely.
Did you go into this thinking I'm going to be all of Jack online?
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah. And because on Twitter, I'm more Fiorella, and I'm not a big Facebook fan. And just because, for me, it's too chaotic. I feel like it's too chaotic for me. And it's a lot of people that I know, you know, like people that I've known from high school or from college or family and stuff like that. And that's great and stuff. But, you know, I kind of just wanted to start conversations with people that I don't know, people that have similar passions and interests, and that are, you know, if I feel like being the yoga girl today, great. If I don't tomorrow, then so be it.
Yeah, it does feel like a better platform to, I guess, experiment with what you want to do with it. I want to say it's a little bit more forgiving.
Yeah.
So, yeah, have you found any interesting groups of people or anything that's really resonated with the interest and the passions of what you want to do now in Google Plus? Or are you not there yet with it? Or are you just, like, there for everybody?
No.
I'm here for the food. I'm here for the free beer.
I'm here for the candy. Love me some Swedish fish. Yeah, they're good, aren't they? There have been different groups. So I'm learning, I've been learning so much just watching how people are using it and stuff. I mean, Daria Musk, you know, her thing with the Google Hangouts is amazing and what she's done and stuff. And then I'm thinking, well, maybe I'll do a Kirtan Hangout and stuff like that. Will people come? I don't know. And, you know, it's a different type of music, and it's kind of a different type of interaction and stuff. But just the sheer fact that people are doing things like that, and you just, that it inspires you to try different things and stuff like that. And then, you know, I became Buddhist, so there are monks, you know, from, like, Tibet and doing hangouts and stuff like that, which is...
Isn't that wild?
Totally wild. And where else can you get that? So in terms of that, yeah, it's really been neat to just explore and see what other people are doing and to try to get ideas. And, I mean, this format here, I think, is just so amazing. So
yeah, it's
pretty
funny
inspiring.
I keep this, when I do these hangouts on air, I keep them to just the person I want to talk to, because I'm technically responsible for the content that shows up here. And I've been on regular non-broadcast hangouts where people get pretty interesting, as I say, the very least. And but yeah, the whole idea of being able to talk to 10 people at once is a little overwhelming, but it's very cool. And it's definitely broadened my worldview, I think, because, you know, you think you participate online, you think you kind of have a grasp on how things work, but this platform, above all else, above even Twitter, I feel for myself, is very global in scope. They get a lot of exposure to other people's ideas and cultures and passions and knowledge and things like that. So it's really good. And I'm glad. I mean, like I said, I've been following you on Twitter and probably wherever else for a while now. But I like the content that you put out there, because I did get to see, like, more of you.
Thank you.
I think that's very cool. I think we're going to wrap this up now, because I'm sure I try to go an hour, but most of the times I'm like, I could chat with people for a long time, because I don't like interviewing people. That's kind of boring. That's kind of Barbara Walters, and I like to have conversations with people. So
yeah,
I've had a great conversation with you, because I didn't get to talk to you enough when, I remember where it was. We were at a bar. It was a book release party.
Yes, it was Jason Falls, right?
Chris's book. That was at a bowling alley. I don't remember what it was, but but that's where I had got to meet you in person. Yeah, and those kind of things. You never get to talk to people enough, or you kind of drive by and stuff like that. So I'm glad that I got to talk to you. We're definitely going to have to go offline and chat more.
Yes.
Not where everybody else is watching.
Thank you so much for inviting me.
I'm
so thankful.
You were like, I don't know why I'm going to be here. And I'm like, because you're amazing and you're interesting and you're inspirational. Duh, that's why I wanted to talk to you.
Thank you. Thank you.
But I'm glad that you got a chance to tell me and everybody else
about
your experiences. I find you highly inspiring and motivational. So I just want to thank you.
Well, thank you so much. And thank you, everybody watching. This is so cool. This is, for those of you that don't know, this is my first official hangout. Because I've been too chicken to press the hangout button. But this is my first hangout, so thank you so much for having me and everybody for watching. I appreciate it.
Well, to be quite honest, I'm scared of public hangouts. It's just like anybody shows up. I'm not that brave yet. I'll go and hang out with people that I know, at least with one person, like that I've known in real life or prior, or that I've come to grow to love through Google Plus. But yeah, I'm not that brave either, so don't feel bad. All right. Good night, everyone. I'm going to close the hangout, and it's all going to close, and I have to say goodbye to Jack now, but I'll catch up with you soon, okay?
Okay. Mwah. Good night.
Get some rest.
Okay, you too. Bye.
Bye.